Good afternoon. Howard Wiig, Code Green, ThinkTech Hawaii. Welcome to our small army of viewers this afternoon. We have a wonderful guest in the form of Melanie Islam, who is with Mason Architects. And she is a LEED certified professional and does some really exciting work that we will hear about very momentarily. But first, I had a bit of a shock a couple of days ago, and I wondered what in the world we green advocates had been smoking, because a conservative friend of mine said, Howard, you've got to listen to this fellow here. And turns out he's a financial advisor, and he loves, well, he doesn't love oil. He says green, you know, PVs, storage, wind, that's all very fine, but oil is our only way out. He didn't quite say out of what, and he was really convincing. And I said, what, again, what have I been smoking around here? But then I went back and listened again, and as an energy professional, I started punching holes in his argument until it looked like just pure Swiss cheese. But he made a point, two points that I had not thought of before, namely, if we're going to power the whole world with photovoltaics plus wind plus storage, we're going to need gazillions and gazillions of PV panels and gazillions of great big batteries. And each of those wind machines takes a heck of a lot of material. And it turns out that the material needed for all three products includes a lot of rare earth metals. And a lot of those metals come from nations that don't like us so much. What are we going to do? What are we going to do? That got me thinking, you know, efficiency. That's my kuleana. PV, wind, storage. That's not enough. We need to shift gears into what I'm terming hyper efficiency. Look for all the other avenues to get us to 100% clean energy. And the first thing that came to mind was building and home restoration. There's a heck of a lot of energy inherent in each building. Think of all that concrete, all that metal, all that glass. In the case of my home, you can see up above there, that's a heck of a lot of wood that went into this residence here. So that was a cornerstone. And then just to back it up, this morning, I saw where the European Union is going to make restoring buildings a capstone of their European New Green Deal, all of which sets up Miss Melanie Islam, because guess what? She specializes in restoration of homes and buildings. And she does just beautiful work. And on that cheery note, why don't you take it away, Miss Islam?
Thank you, Howard, so much. Hi, everyone. My name is Melanie Islam. I'm an architect, sustainability director at Mason, formerly known as Mason Architects. So like Howard said, we're an architecture historic consulting practice. We've been practicing in Hawaii, Honolulu, for nearly 30 years. So we have sort of a lot of feet in the ground, a lot of experience. But you know, Howard, you brought up an excellent point. You talked about all that energy that is living in our existing buildings. You know, well, we're starting to sort of talk about this conversation and starting to sort of look at embodied carbon. You know, as architects, you know, the AIA just updated sort of our code of ethics, but more importantly, sort of updated our charge and our responsibility to the environment. And one of the big things is how do we more succinctly tie in with our work, reduction of carbon, and looking at sort of the clean energy goals. And in fact, looking at existing buildings is one of the big things that we need to start doing. I think everyone in this audience that buildings basically sort of emit about 40% sort of emissions, right, in the larger picture. And how do we sort of bring that down? We don't often have the opportunity to sort of build new all the time. So we have to look at how do we preserve our existing building stock. Some of those are historic treasures that we'll never be able to replace. And how do we have modernize that and make that more efficient? So I'm just really happy to be here to sort of share some of the work that we're doing at Mason. That's what I call currently in construction, and some upcoming things that are in our community. So Howard, how do you want to do this?
I would like to, first I want to point out that another advantage of doing restoration or reuse is job creation. Guess
exactly
who?
Exactly right. Yeah.
Jobs. Hawaii, the unemployment rate is bad at about 8%. Last time I looked, our unemployment rate was, it had come much better than in March or April, but it's still up 12%. And a lot of those are people who could be searching for a new career other than washing dishes in Waikiki or whatever. And restoration involves skilled labor. You need to get training, and you have once you get that job, it's a well-paying job. So there's another advantage too. Restoration as opposed to new building. So why don't you
start your
projects?
Sure, yeah. So I thought I'd share a couple of the work that is currently going on in Mason, a couple of projects that I'm working on that deal with existing building reuse, adaptation of those buildings, and also secondly, how to we sort of deconstruct those buildings and sort of extend the life of the materials in them. So the first one that I wanted to share is a project that we've been sort of working on Coconut Island. So I think a lot of people know what Coconut Island is. It lives sort of in the middle of Kaneohe Bay. We've been fortunate enough to sort of work on one of the first structures there for the university and for HIB, the Hawaii Institute of Marine Biology. It's over 30,000 square feet. It's actually two structures. It was originally one of the first lab buildings there, but what, like many of sort of the entitlements work and how land use changes over time, the building itself sits in an SMA zone. So removing the structure was basically not possible, but we need to sort of meet programmatic needs for the university. So we were hired to look at how do we modernize the structure. So what we did was we sort of brought the building down to its bones. We're essentially retaining a lot of the existing shell and the roof, all that sort of embodied carbon that lives in the masonry, that lives sort of in that sort of light gauge steel, that structural sort of steel assembly. We're preserving that, and we're not modernizing the building by bringing it up to code. So we had to fully grout the building. But the really important thing is the university as a whole is sort of working towards a larger energy efficiency sort of target, right? Energy efficiency reduction, I think by 2030, 2035, they sort of have all these sort of incremental timelines. And our intent with this project was to ensure that the work that we do at HIMB was sort of meeting those targets. So as an existing structure, we had to look creatively at how do we insulate this building? How do we sort of beef up the thermal performance at the walls, at the windows? And as labs, they consume a lot of energy. How do we sort of bring that energy footprint down? And then how do we couple and add sort of renewable technology to that? So I think a lot of you guys are sort of seeing the slides. The top one there is really what the building looked like gutted. So essentially, we created a new palette to work from. And then we sort of created a bunch of new sort of laboratory buildings. We have two types of labs in the structure. One that fully is naturally ventilated and sort of daylit. So that really helps to sort of bring down the energy footprint. We're, you know, practicing a lot of the tenets that were sort of brought up in our new 2015 IECC co-adoption, which looks at passive ventilation through the space, use of ceiling fans to sort of move that cold air through. So that's all the ground floor, and that really works nicely with the program because that's a fully sort of wet water, seawater lab that where you're, you know, scientists, lab assistants are bringing in all these sort of wet samples. So this space needs to be durable, but it needs to be efficient and needs to be nicely ventilated and daylit. The second image, which is like on the top, it's on my top right, maybe it's on your top left, but that's of your more typical sort of laboratory building that has those really sort of tight air change changes, which are like 4 to 6, you know, air handle changes. So that requires a lot of energy. It also sort of has the traditional sort of fume hood that kind of, it pulls a lot of energy as well too. So when we started to study this building, what we did was we beefed up the insulation on the roof. We put in sort of insulation and thermal resistance in the wall cavity. We beefed up sort of the window assembly. And then we sort of modeled, you know, we kind of sort of studied the daylight in the building, and we situated sort of window glazing performance as needed. So overall, we brought down the building use to about 20%, which was above the baseline. And then adding our renewables brought the efficiency up to 40% as well, too. So in all, it's a really great, I think, story of how do you reuse existing structures that can be modernized, but yet can still meet the code and sort of the larger sort of intents of our state. So we think this is a really great project that has a lot of really great points to it: natural ventilation, efficiency, daylighting, renewables. The other project I wanted to talk about is, you know, Howard, you sort of talked about single family residents, right? They are everywhere. Single family residents is something that we're all going to be sort of impacted by, but we can most importantly sort of connect with. The next project it's not a reuse project. I would call it, in the traditional sense, it's a more of a deconstruction, and we sort of built new, but built new with intention of being energy efficient and sort of bridging together sort of the tense of what the client wanted in terms of a contemporary lifestyle, but we need larger goals. So this home, it's your traditional single wall construction home in Hawaii. One story has a combination of redwood, you know, single wall plank plus a combination of masonry. So we were really concerned, the client was really concerned about what their footprint would be. So what we did was we worked with Reuse Hawaii, and we actually deconstructed the home. And that was a great thing because it allowed us to divert about 70 to 80% of construction waste. In Hawaii, we have landfill sort of issues where we're not able to sort of bring the waste there. We're not able to sort of look at reuse. So doing this allowed us to take something that would traditionally probably go in the landfill, bring it to Reuse Hawaii, and have someone else sort of upcycle and reuse it. So that in itself is a good way of how do you sort of salvage material, salvage sort of that embodied carbon and energy in it for someone else to reuse. With that, then it gave us sort of a new slate to sort of rebuild a new structure. So we built a new structure, two dwellings, sort of has an ADU attached to it as well. So it looks and starts to address some of the housing issues in Hawaii. But the home, again, sort of designed to be as efficient as possible. We use natural ventilation and sort of daylight as a baseline. So the home has cross ventilation throughout, a lot of windows, but a nice sort of balance into wall ratio. And we sort of added a 35 kilowatt sort of PV array to sort of both structures to allow us to have some renewable efficiencies in there. We also plumbed portions of the house to have additional PV put in for that, so that the owners can start to sort of see how they're using the home and sort of, you know, add array as needed. So those are like some of the works that we're doing at Mason to sort of just address the synergies between efficiency, renewables, and existing sort of building stock. What else are we doing, Howard? I know we talked about a couple other things. A really great project. I think many of you guys know, you know, recently sort of in the news, YWC Fernhurst was in the news a lot for the great social impact work that it does with WCCC. So we at Mason have been really fortunate to have a great partnership with the YWCA and sort of work with them at their Fernhurst facility and look at ways of, I think more importantly, how does the facility support the mission and purpose of a nonprofit. So it actually first started off with sort of volunteer work that I was sort of doing with the YWC. Sort of 3 years ago, we worked a lot sort of with the women that come from WCCC that sort of live at the Y and envisioned and talked stories with them of what they saw the future to be like at the facility. And when it pointed out, you know, and I think a lot of these things are coming up in conversation about social equity and access, right? What it pointed out is that what privileges are taken away from women or men when they get incarcerated, and what are the first things that they want back? And we found that gathering was important, having sort of ability to sort of connect with people and spaces to provide that, but also providing spaces that allow women to sort of build their independence and build sort of that social structure that was deconstructed when they were incarcerated. And one of those first things starts with food. I think food is a piece that connects with all of us, right? It allows us to bridge connections, make conversations. So we started with food, and we identified that there was a need to have cooking there. Fernhurst has always historically been sort of like a lodging facility for women, but it doesn't have any cooking facilities there. You know, it just sort of has a serving kitchen. So a lot of the food that comes in and out of that facility are through restaurants and nonprofit organizations that bring lunch, breakfast, and dinner meals. So our first phase of work was really to provide what we're calling the home kitchen, where women can build upon their independence and they can cook their own meals. And so sort of coupled with that, we worked with a great suite of engineers. We're sort of all donating our services pro bono to look at then what is the water efficiency in space? What is the energy efficiency in space? And using opportunities from the CARES Act funding, which they receive, and also Hawaii Energy's Energy Relief Grant, which is afforded to nonprofits, to upgrade lighting efficiency throughout the space. And really just tie in some of the things that we do in all of our sort of private and public practice, but bring it down to a level where it's accessible for everyone, and that everyone knows that, you know, getting access to good quality design, good quality products, and efficiency is not something of privilege. It is equitable and accessible to everyone. So this is just a great project that we've been working on. We're providing a home kitchen. We're renovating a couple of their dining and multi-purpose spaces, some of their living room gathering spaces. We're also looking at the roof repair. So we're adding insulation on so we can improve the thermal comfort of the total facility. So we're doing sort of like piecemeal, but I think impactful work to the envelope and to the main floor of the building. So that's just one other project that I thought I'd share that deals with an existing structure, looks at efficiency and whatnot. So yeah, that's our work, Howard.
Thank you. So one important point you are indirectly making is the fact that technology is improving hand over fist. There's something, a law called Haight's Law. It's named after the electrical engineer. And it says that every 18 months, the cost of LED lights shall drop by 25%, while the efficacy, the efficiency of the lamp shall increase by something like 50%. And there is an upper limit.
I didn't know that.
And so I'll give you a little quiz. I needed some lamps
myself. Oh, gosh. Okay.
It's a lamp that's giving me illumination right over here. This is a plain old, what used to look, it looks like an incandescent lamp, but these days it's an LED. And it's just a plain old screw in, nothing fancy about it. Guess what the efficacy was, is?
85?
Up. More?
93? 100.
More?
Higher.
106.6 lumens per watt. Okay. Lumens per watt is how we measure miles per gallon in lights. And this is just plain the shelf thing. Oh, here's an, you're too young to remember incandescent lights.
I know incandescent lights. I had that in the house I grew up in.
What is the what is the efficacy of your typical incandescent light?
I don't know, 40? I should know this. This looks really bad. 20, 15, 10. Yes.
15 lumens per watt, close to 106 lumens per watt. That is an increase of sevenfold. Lights. The Latin word for white hot heat is incandescent. Guess what that light is called? The incandescent light. A state senator measure the heat of a 100-watt incandescent, and he got 465 degrees.
Okay.
And at what temperature did you used to bake cookies? 300
I think so. I don't bake. So I'm thinking like what? I cook.
Anyway, the point being that energy codes or all building codes turn over or get renewed every 3 years. Why? Because exactly what we're talking about here. Technology is so rapidly now.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so that's why I can see where you keep up with all the latest of the latest of the latest.
I love the code. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And just regarding Fernhurst, you know, it benefits all of us when you're helping disadvantaged people, be they men or women, because they don't have the skills, the really basic skills that most of us grew up with. And so you're
I've been volunteering for the Y, I think, long before Fernhurst, but I found, you know, that statement is true, but I also found, interestingly, like someone like myself, right, you just get into some hard times, could easily also be incarcerated. Those stories actually have been most impactful with me, someone that could be my kin, could be in my cohort and my age group, that just happened to stumble along the wrong path and sort of got incarcerated. But I think it's like all these things could happen. But I think the main point is that, you know, good design, access to efficiency, integration of all these principles that we're talking about, and knowing that you have an impact and a role in making a positive impact to your environment is afforded to everyone. It is not a privilege. It is not something about entitlement. We can all be part of it. And it's just a matter of how do we break down those barriers and start those conversations.
And speaking of energy efficiency, and this was something, we're living in a COVID age, and putting on webinars or hosting webinars about UVC, ultraviolet C lighting, and that's the end of the spectrum. And that spectrum actually zaps the COVID, it disables them. So the question is how to get it safely in there. But one of the things I have found in doing considerable research, this ties into what you're doing too, you're promoting the natural ventilation whenever possible. Turns out that one of the most effective means of avoiding the COVID is being outdoors, because outdoors you've got all of this air circulation all over the place. Right. And say, even if you're walking 6 feet behind somebody who has the COVID up there, some of those little rascals are going to reach you, but there's something called dose. And most of them are flying all over the place. So your dosage is very, very low and your immune system can handle it. So you're talking about natural ventilation coming through an interior space. That is also a very, very effective anti-COVID measure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure. We found some fans for Fernhurst, big-ass fans. Haiku has the UVC built into their standard stock. So we're going to install a couple of them into the facility and see how they work. So.
Great minds think alike.
Thanks for bringing that up.
Speaking of fans, I'm the energy codes guy, as you may know. I'm introducing into the next generation of codes is mandatory ceiling fans, even for this is in residence, even for centrally air conditioned homes, because typical. Yep. Planes is centrally air conditioned. Our climate is so beautiful that on a nice cool evening, can open up the window, turn off the AC, save yourself some money, and with the ceiling fans. And again, you've got this great air circulation, and you're reducing your COVID exposure.
For sure. Yeah, exactly. That's great. I look forward to seeing that and hearing the conversations related behind that in our community.
We always get pushback from the builders. Howard, that's going to cost.
I know.
Yeah, I know.
We need to take bold actions, though, Howard, in order to really reduce our carbon footprint. You know, we can't do these incremental little changes. We need to take bold actions. That's one of the,
You're speaking my language here. So
I thought I'd share some.
We've just got a minute or two left. Do you have any events that you would like to announce?
Yes, I would. I just want to take this time. So coupled with just the work I do, I also sit on the board for UHGBC Hawaii. It's a U.S. Green Building Council that administers sort of the LEED program, a bunch of other sort of suites of programs from Green Building Services. And so we have upcoming a town hall with our CEO Mahesh Ramanjaman on October 5th. And so it'd be a really great opportunity for our community to, we're intending to have an engaging session. It's gonna be a conversation really to talk about the future of USGBC, how it's working in Hawaii, and how can the role of green building help to sort of advance our economy and sort of rebuild in this post-pandemic time. So I welcome you all to sort of join. There's a registration link on the image above. We also have the next day some training to really sort of, we were talking earlier about workforce training. We're going to be doing training on LEED Zero and LEED Carbon. So how do we sort of bring our, looking at how do we bring our sort of building usage down and also couple with that our carbon footprint. So that also sort of has a registration link. That's going to be sort of a session where people that are professionals that need CEUs, you can get 3 hours of CEU credits. So we look forward to having that on October 6th on the 8 o'clock in the morning. And the last thing that's really kind of personal to me is Hydrogen Day. That's also coming up this week on October 8th. I say personal because I have a hydrogen vehicle and I did that intentionally to sort of start to look at how can we support alternative technology to kind of, you know, be in parallel with pure electric vehicles to kind of get to a clean energy world. So we're kicking off our first sort of Hydrogen Day on the 8th. It's intended to be a really fun-filled sort of morning session. I think it's headed by Blue Panda, and I think even also the State Energy Office. So yeah, tune in. And then, yeah, but those are the three events that are coming up next week. So hopefully you guys can join if any that are of interest.
And did you by any chance include a slide that includes your contact information?
Oh yeah, I think it's like one of the last ones. There we go. Okay. That's me.
Is that it? So, yep. Okay, because we've got about 20 seconds left. So there is Melanie's contact information. She would love to hear from you and keep up the wonderful, wonderful work. Melanie,
Thanks, Howard.
On a tidal wave. It's a small wave now, but the whole renovation thing will turn into a wonderful tsunami. And on that cheery
note, we hope so, yeah.
We must bid fond farewell from ThinkTech Howard Wiig. Say fond farewell, Melanie. Bye-bye.
Bye.